killed within the first week.
Oh, no.
So the locals decided they had to do something to protect the horses. They petitioned the federal government, state government, local government, and got all the donations they could get together, and they bought a piece of land or an island out in Currituck Sound called Dewey's Island. Uninhabited. Same vegetation and stuff as here. They loaded the horses all on barges and took them over to Dewey's Island. Well, the people came back. Well, so did the horses. The horses swam back. And within a couple weeks, they were all back here. So that's when they constructed that fence down that we've seen on the left or right as we came on. And 11 and a half miles up, there's another one. It runs the same way. And then it's fenced in all the way to the sound, back around. The steel Grateby Cross coming in, that gate there never shuts. The horses will not walk across that. They can see through it, they won't walk across it because of getting their hooves caught in it.
And they know that.
500 years ago, can't really see them now because the tides come in. There's you'll see some throughout. There's a bunch of stumps that sticks up.
Yeah, I saw them.
You saw some?
Right.
Okay, 500 years ago, this here was all maritime forest. The ocean was actually a mile further out. When the Spanish settled here, they brought the Mustangs with them. And they got the Mustangs here to tow their timber and their game that they killed. But they found that they could not walk in the sand. It was too soft for them. So they mated the Spanish Mustang with a North African barb horse. And it's got what we have here today, what we're calling the Spanish Mustangs. The domestic horse has a U-shaped chest. Its legs are mounted on the outsides of the shoulders. It walks hind foot, front foot. When you look at these horses, they have an A-shaped chest. The legs are mounted closer to the center of the breast. When they walk, they take their one foot in front of the other, hind feet and front feet, just like that. They only actually walk in a line about that wide when they walk. The University of Kentucky came here in the late 90s and took 17 DNA samples of the horses. They found they are thoroughbred Spanish Mustangs, the only ones left in the United States that have not been tainted by domestic horse blood. No domestic horses has ever mated with these horses. So you won't see no white horses, painted horses, pintos, or anything like that. You're going to see a sorrel, which is tan with a blonde mane, we hope. We hope to see any of these horses. Green and blowing. You will see a bay, which is a tan horse with a black mane, a chestnut, which is reddish colored, and then your black and brown. That's all we have out here. Another difference in them, they only have 5 vertebrae versus 6 for a domestic horse. So they're almost a foot shorter in length than a domestic horse. They are only 13 to 15 hands high versus 18 to 24 for a domestic horse.
It's smaller.
So they are pony-sized horses. You'll look at them from a distance and say, no, they're big, and you get up to them, you'll see they're small. We do not supplement their food supply at all. What they have is out here for them to eat. If you feed them carrots and apples and things like that, that's the reason they say do not feed the horses. They'll develop colic and die. Their systems are not used to them. They eat sea oats, briars, tree bark, acorns, blackberries, persimmons. They drink from the ocean, which is salt water. They will drink from the sound, which is a brackish. It has a salt content to it. And they drink from the natural ponds, which have salt content to it. What the salt does for them, it acts as a natural vaccination. We do not vaccinate the horses either. It acts as a natural vaccination. It kills all the mites and worms and things like that they might get. A horse's teeth continues to grow throughout its life. They have to be shaved down by their owners. We do not do that to these horses. The sand does it. As they eat, everything out here has got so much sand in it, it keeps their teeth ground down. If one of them gets sick or injured and has to be removed from this area, it can never come back. They do not allow them to come back due to bringing in outside diseases and then their immune system being weak from the vaccinations and stuff that they get when they leave. So those horses are put up for adoption. Anybody have any questions?
How many are there?
There is between 100 and 130. It's a big spread, but everybody I've asked gives me a different number.
Okay,
between 100 and 130.
That's a lot.
So it's somewhere in between there. They have 8,000 acres to roam on, 100 to 130 horses still. 80% of that is privately owned. We are only allowed to go on about 20% of that privately owned land. The other 20% of the land is owned by the federal government. We cannot go on any of it. So if the horses decide to seek shelter way back in the woods, we will not be able to go see them.
Who removes them?
I'm sorry?
Who removes them when they're sick?
The Horse Foundation.
Really?
There's constant patrols out here all the time.
What's the lifespan?
About 20 years, 18 to 20 years. I won't tell y'all what I told that lady the other day. She asked me how long they live. I said, well, we let them get to about 12 and then we eat them.
They sold them to a glue factory.
She was a horse lover.
Are there other areas around here that have wild horses besides
here? Chincoteague and Ocracoke, but they've been tainted by domestic horses.
Oh, really? So this is the only pure?
These are not penned up at all.
Okay.
You'll see some inside a fencing, but that's people's property where they've either jumped the fence or went around and got in it.
Interesting.
What was that?
Chinka-tinka.
Yep, I think that's it.
Okay. How high is the fence around here?
I'm sorry?
How high is the fence?
The fences that keep them in
are
about 6 feet high, and some of them even higher than that. People's yards, is if they don't want the horses in, are about 5 to 6 feet high. If they do want them in, then it's just a regular decorative fence. It's against the law to corral one. So if you have a fence around your house, it either has to be open on both ends or shut all the way around at all times. If you leave your house and it's in your yard and you don't know it and you shut your gate and the horse people come by, it's a $500 fine.
Wow.
You get within 50 feet, it's a $500 fine. So, and you don't want to touch them anyway. I mean, they'll walk right up to you. You can touch them, but if you try to, they'll bite. We had a lady lose 3 fingers trying to feed one an apple.
Well,
that was about 3 years ago.
Well,
they do bite. So they're not afraid, but they're not tame.
Yeah.
And if you have a baby close by, and the stallion starts feeling threatened, he will let you know that he's threatened. So
really?
We try to stay 50 feet or further back. Sometimes we get a little closer. If we see something on the side of the road, drive by and follow me about the same speed I drive by. You got a camera, just come to almost a complete stop and take your pictures. But if you get too close to them, they will stick their head in the teeth and you don't want a horse slobber on you. It's kind of stink. All right, we'll go see if